procedures were from your authority so that you have it already set in place.
I'd just like to change my mind, just to bring in Graham, who has that a bit more detail.
So, just to be clear,
well, just a question.
So, the duty, as I understand it, to protect properties and to ensure there's effects left and all those sort of things, does extend to people who aren't current clients of adult social care. I think the issue was that the hospital were asking the team to get involved in cases where the protection of property element didn't exist, if you like, if you've got any insurance and all those sort of things. So, the role of the kicks in when someone's admitted into hospital as an emergency, and there may be personal circumstances which require the home to be made secure and any pets to be made safer, etc. It does only apply where there's no other next of kin or family in order to do that. And similarly with public health burials, we still undertake quite a lot of public health burials, in fact, more in the last couple of years than we have ever done before, where there's no family available to undertake those duties.
Just want to say we have that, the hospitals are aware of what the procedures and the practices are to be, rather than ad hoc getting in touch with the authority and asking for that to be done, so that it's actually going down, and it's just another being communicated with the Grey ones that we
need. Yes, as far as I'm aware, we have communicated that to hospitals. I think they were uncertain about their old responsibilities in some of these cases to begin with, because they'd always come to council. We have said even if they had next of kin or something. So we have spoken to the hospitals, and as far as I'm aware, we have got a good process in place now where they know where to go. The criteria, so we've mapped all the policies and procedures and criteria. The criteria doesn't fit every single thing that happens, so there is a bit of flexibility there. And the relationship we have with social services, social workers, and the hospitals is a lot better. So it's just a matter of talking to each other, really, and just assessing if there is something that happens that we are not fully within the criteria, and we just work that through as to what we're doing in those circumstances.
Okay. All right. And the new processes will protect that. So, that's key in these sort of matters too. Right, thank you very much. Just wanted us to know that you were saying thank you for the work that you've done. We crack on, we've got the return audit update. Now, some people have spotted Barnes here. That's because he is sick. He's finally got his operational support. I believe it's very painful.
It is. He's recovered well. So I have a few more details in the next couple of days, which will come
on. Okay. So Ian, who's Mark's deputy, is that right?
Yeah.
Is going to cover this particular item for us. So away you go, Ian.
Okay, thank you, Jay. Yes, I'm Ian Wallace. I'm the internal manager that works to Mark. So Mark's obviously prepared a report before he's gone off, so I'd just like to cover some of the highlights from the report. So in keeping with previous reports, the report takes the structure piece that's out there in 3.1, covers each of those key areas. So it covers work reported in the period 1st of September to 31st of October 2019. In terms of item of note, there's five items there I just want to briefly touch on. So reference there to Rural Health and Care Commissioning. So, similar to last year, we're doing a joint piece of work with Merseyside Internal Audit Agency. So that's a joint piece of work that's looking at those areas that you can see there in the bullets at the bottom of the page. In terms of the personal finance unit, section 3.2, there was a review of the personal finance unit in late 2018. So that highlighted a number of findings, a number of audit recommendations, including two high priority recommendations that we list there. So we've done a piece of follow-up from that work on that recently. So the conclusion from that is significant progress has been made in implementing all the agreed recommendations. We highlight there about the review of the membership government structure of the death plan being completed, new terms of reference implemented, and also the service level agreement that's been developed, and that's now in the final stages of being signed. 3.2C there refers to health, safety and wellbeing, so there's been a new group of wellbeing, health, safety, wellbeing board we recently established, so we're represented on that, so able to give advice and views, and also to be able to target specific assurance work as becomes necessary. 3.2D refers to the Windows 10 rollout project. That's schedule for that is to be completed in January 2020. So there was a number of recommendations that came out of that review. Three high priority recommendations in relation to the resources of the project. The resources are in place now that that original deadline of January 20 is scheduled to be met. A couple of high priority recommendations around stock managing and the purchasing arrangements. So we'll continue to monitor the recommendations that we've made there. And then finally, in terms of items of note, the counter-fraud publicity campaign, just to highlight a change, it talks there about this particular fraud awareness campaign, fraud awareness week commencing on the 11th of January, actually commenced on the 18th of January. So that's in collaboration with other sections of the council, it's referred to in that paragraph. And as the second paragraph highlights, the aim really is to heighten members of the public and employees' awareness of the scale nature, impact of fraud, signs to look out for, but also reminders, visible reminders of how they can report procedures and progress as well. So there's a number of elements to that. There's certainly internally, there's screensavers, there's a blog that's been done, a podcast that's been done, but also out in the sort of the area offices as well, the town hall, kind of very visible banner there in terms of setting out things to be mindful of, to notice, to be on the lookout for, and also obviously numbers to be text or addresses to report any concerns in that area. Section 3.3 there talks about the recommendations, so the schedule to the report provides detail of the audits that have been completed in this period, follow-up work that's been completed in this period as well. And we've got a reference there in 3.3b. We're going to bring a more comprehensive position statement on a number of the audit reviews, particularly around information management, information governance. Come back for that next time. And then finally, 3.4 gives a current position on the performance indicators for the section, and 3.5 enables some improvement plans.
Super, thank you very much. Any questions to hear about that? No? I'm sure we'll pass on the best wishes.
We may be watching.
No, that's a really worrying thought. I'm conscious that we also agreed a long time ago that the chair, vice chair spoke to people would get an opportunity to come in and look at the details in these audit reports that were coming back as well. So I think this particular round was an exciting one, but when Mark's back on both feet, I'm sure that will. So, thank you for that. Now, who's taking us through the annual self-assessment?
So, in line with CFST's best practice guidance for the committees, there's been annual evaluation of the role and the effectiveness of ARMC. That's been completed. That was using the self-assessment checklist that's been provided by CFST. So, what you've got in Appendix 1 is the completed checklist. What you've got in Appendix 2 is the action plan from that. Perhaps I can just draw your attention to paragraphs 3.6 and then 3.5 on page 102. So, 3.6 just makes the point that self assessment and evaluation concludes that the audit and risk management committee fulfills its core objectives, all of which align with best practice, and have been a number of areas identified and they're being picked up in the action plan. And then, paragraph 3.5 just makes the point that Chair has utilised the checklist to complete the evaluation, prepare the action plan. The views expressed are those of the Chair, so the purpose of this report is to present to the wider committee the views to be able to come to a final conclusion to the outcome and the action plan.
Okay. Thank you for that. So, yes, so Mark and I went through this, showing it here. If people think that's a fair representation of where we were. It's not all sweetness and light, we can get better. We've already spoken about the latest guidance that we haven't seen this one. So, are people content to agree that as a way forward in the action plan? Okay, thank you. If we then move on to the annual report, Ian, are you doing that again? Or is,
yeah, just briefly. Really disappointed with the cover there in the front summary, really. So, again, to comply with the recommendations for best practice. The ARMC is required to complete an annual report on the work undertaken by the committee. So what you've got attached to Appendix A is the annual report prepared by the chairs over the period of the last 18 months in consultation with the chief internal auditor.